Good morning, everybody. Grace and peace to you on this Lord's Day. I'm Jim Hoffman. I had the privilege of being senior pastor here at St. John's United Methodist Church. I had the privilege of also welcoming you to our hour of worship together here at St. John's. If you are a regular attender or a member of our congregation and on our email list, you would have received an email this morning that had all the links to be able to sign in for worship. It also had our worship guide contained, and so you'd be able to click the link on it, open our worship guide so that you can participate in our order of worship this morning. Also has a sign-in link on it as well, so we would encourage you to take a moment to sign in there. You can also sign in through the comment sections of both Facebook Live and our live stream as well. But we would certainly appreciate you doing that so that we could know that you are present with us. As I said, your worship guide has everything that you need to be able to participate in our order of worship. Just simply follow along today. Also has the invitations for this week, and so I would encourage you to take a moment to read through all of those. They are important things for you to know, opportunities for you to be involved, and so we would encourage you to be informed by reading through them. Also want to remind you, read your Friday ministry news as well. When it comes out, it has even more detail on some other things like programs and classes that are involved here at St. John's. And so in order to be up to date on those, I would encourage you to also read your Friday ministry news. For now, as we continue in our order of worship today, I'm going to invite you to turn to page number 2 in your worship guide. Our opening hymn this morning is going to be Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart. It's United Methodist hymn number 160, and we're going to sing together stanzas 1, 3, and 5. We're going to stand here at the church. If you would like to at home, we'd encourage you to do so also as we sing. Page 3 of your worship guide, you will find our call to worship for this morning. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to be silent, and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. God has made everything suitable for its time. God has put a sense of past and future into our minds. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before Him. Whatever God does endures forever. Our hymn of praise this morning is As a Fire is Meant for Burning. It is from The Faith We Sing, number 2237.
As the fire is snatched up heaven,
seated, everyone.
Good morning. I'm Marilyn Center, a member of the Children's Ministry here at St. John's United Methodist. And this message is meant for the children and those children at heart. You know, I don't know about you, but I've been thinking it's a little hot outside lately. It's a little too hot for me to do any of the things I like to do. It's too hot for me to go outside and do stuff in the yard. It's too hot for me to take the dog for a walk. It's too hot for me to even stand outside and talk to the neighbors. It's really too hot to do most of anything except maybe running through sprinklers or maybe eating popsicles. Not bad. But it's already July, so we're really only a couple of months from fall when things start to get cooler, and that's when we can really get outside and start doing stuff, right? We can go outside, and we can have picnics, and we can kick balls around with our friends, and it's really pretty great out there. But then comes winter. It's all blustery and cold. I gotta tell you, it's really not my favorite season. And I have to confess, sometimes I wonder why God even decided we had to have winter. But without winter, without the snow, we wouldn't have snowmen, we wouldn't have sledding. That's kind of cool, right? Cool. Oh, sorry. Then, once all that snow melts, we finally get to my favorite season, spring. In spring, all the leaves start coming up, and the grass starts coming up, and there are just so many shades of green, I really can't quit talking about it. Trust me. People will tell you, I can't quit talking about it. And then there are all the beautiful flowers that pop up. And it's just colorful everywhere you look, and I just feel so renewed. But God says that every season has a purpose. So yes, even winter has its purpose, and I'm going to have to begrudgingly admit, that. Not only do seasons have their purpose, but times of our lives have their purpose too. There are times in our lives that are just great, when everything is fun and we're just playing all the time and singing and dancing and having a great time. But there are also times in life when things are a little bit sadder and a little bit harder to deal with. We're going through some pretty difficult times right now. We aren't able to see our friends and family as much as we really want to, and a lot of our summer plans have just disappeared or changed in a really big way. But we have to know that just as the seasons change and spring comes again, so do these difficult times, and they will disappear, and we will go back to those joyful times with our friends and our family. What I want you to know today is that seasons will change. Bad times and good times come and go. You will change. Your friends, your family members will change. Your homeschool or church may even experience changes. But know this, God will never change. He will always be there to help you through. God says that he's made everything beautiful in its time. And that means that we can take on the worst seasons of life and turn them into something even more beautiful than we could have possibly imagined. Our God is incredible. Will you bow your heads with me and pray for just a moment? Thank you, Lord, for giving us seasons to experience. We know that each season of the year and each season of our lives has something to teach us, something that will make us stronger. Thank you, Lord, for our incredible world. Amen.
And while we're thinking about prayer, we're going to move now to our time of our joys and our concerns. This is an opportunity for us to think about the things that we are joyous about in our lives, that we want to celebrate, the blessings that we have, also the things that are weighing upon our hearts and our minds. And so I'm going to invite us all to a time of private prayer, an opportunity for you to share with God what's on your own heart and mind in this moment. In a few moments, I'll lead us in a pastoral prayer. We'll pause. We have a tradition that we normally, when we're together, to name people out loud so that others might hear and pray for. We believe that that still happens through the power of the Spirit. So we're going to give you an opportunity to lift up a name if you would like to at home. And then I invite everyone that is present to join with me in the Lord's Prayer. You will see that at the bottom of page 6 in your worship guide. So let's take this moment now to pause and to pray. O gracious and holy God, we come before you in this moment of prayer, thinking about the words from our call to worship today, and the words that Marilyn has shared with the kids and the adults watching. To be reminded that our lives are truly seasonal in the way in which they are formed and shaped and lived. We think about the stages of being a child to a young person, to a young adult, into middle age, and then becoming a senior. Those are seasons of our lives. Education may be a season of our life. Getting married, having children, watching our parents age, watching those around us go into your glory. These are all seasons of our lives. Figuring out what we're going to do for work, having a career, bouncing back and forth between multiple things maybe, retiring. It's a season to season to season. Even our church life has seasons to it as well. The seasons of the calendar and the year that we follow from Advent on into Christmas time, coming to Lent and Easter. We find ourselves now in the middle of what we call ordinary time, that's after Pentecost. And we'll be celebrating this and journeying through this time until we come to Advent again. Church life has its seasons. Some of our seasons are like spring. Everything is new, it's beautiful, it is blossoming. It's like a big blessing in a bouquet. And other times, our season is more like a desert. It's dry, it's hot, it's parched. Life has turned in a direction that we did not expect it to go. We have many that are on our prayer list that are going through seasons of their lives. Some of them are joyous seasons for them. Others, it's pain, it's trial, it's tribulation. So may we be reminded, as the first chapter of the Epistle of James says, that all these things that we will go through, these seasons that we will go through, they will produce in us endurance. They will make us mature and complete, and they will give us a faith that we can hang on to all our lives. So use all these seasons for your purpose in our own hearts and lives and in the lives of those that we're praying for today. And may we know that whatever season of life we find ourselves in this moment, it's probably only temporary, for there'll be another season just around the corner. We ask that you walk with us always, O God, through these, that your love and your spirit form and shape each and every one of us, and that we might know the depth of your love and your presence, not only through your spirit, but through our community that comes to surround us. Be with us, O God, in these our prayers. And now we pause to lift up any names that might be upon our hearts and minds that we wish to share in this moment of prayer. And so all these things we pray in the name of your Son, who is our Lord and Savior, and the one who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
our scripture reading this morning is Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 15. They are from the Common English Bible, and here is what the writer recorded for us. There is a season for everything, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time for giving birth and a time for dying. A time for planting and a time for uprooting what was planted. A time for killing and a time for healing. A time for tearing down and a time for building up. A time for crying and a time for laughing. A time for mourning and a time for dancing. A time for throwing stones and a time for gathering stones. A time for embracing and a time for avoiding embraces. A time for searching and a time for losing. A time for keeping and a time for throwing away. A time for tearing and a time for repairing. A time for keeping silent and a time for speaking. A time for loving and a time for hating. A time for war and a time for peace. What do workers gain from all their hard work? I have observed the task that God has given human beings. God has made everything fitting in its time, but has also placed eternity in their hearts, without enabling them to discover what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there's nothing better for them but to enjoy themselves and do what's good while they live. Moreover, this is the gift of God, that all people should eat, drink, and enjoy the results of their hard work. I know that whatever God does will last forever. It's impossible to add to it or take away from it. God has done this so that people are reverent before Him. Whatever happens has already happened, and whatever will happen has already happened before, and God looks after what is driven away. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Youth and Family Ministries, and I have the privilege of giving today's sermon. Now, the title of today's sermon is May All Your Pains Be Champagne. Now, a few months before my husband and I were to be married, we were invited on a road trip and an opportunity to go to Colorado. We were young and in love, and we jumped on the opportunity to go into too small of a cabin with too many people. Now, with everything COVID right now, it's kind of hard to think of a time where we would do this, and it seems like a lifetime ago. Travis and I, we mainly did our own thing. We hiked, we ate, we walked around Breckenridge. It was about 2 months before our wedding, so it was nice to get away from the stress and the planning of it. Now, I don't know about you, but do you ever wish that you could go back in time and maybe slap your young, naive self? Well, as Travis and I walked around talking about how perfect our lives would be and everything, we were doing some window shopping. And while we were doing some window shopping, we came across a little art store. And we were talking about all of the life's ups and downs that we would have. And inside this art store, there was a little rectangular piece of art, and it was made out of copper. And I instantly fell in love with it. And on the face of it was two champagne glasses, all nice and bubbly. And then on the sides of it, on one side, it was written, "May all your joys be pure joys." And on the other side of it, it read, "And may all your pains be champagne." Now, this piece was around $150, which to two broke, almost newlyweds was way too much of an expense. So I left it in the store, but I always really liked the saying, and I thought it was really cute. Well, little to my knowledge, Travis had snuck back to this little art store, bought it because he saw how much I loved it, and gave it to me about a week before our wedding as a little early wedding present. And I still have this piece of art in my house to this day, and I look at the little bubbly champagne glasses thinking, may all your joys be true joys, and may all of your pains only be champagne. Now, it's been almost a decade, and I can say that my husband loves to talk about our monthly budget. And he always talks nonstop about are we on budget or not. He is definitely a penny pincher. He is not one that believes in Valentine's Day. He thinks it is a made-up corporate holiday. So for him to have snuck back and bought this little piece of art for me It reminds me of such a sweet gesture, and it makes me happy. Now, the phrase, "May all of your pains be champagne," I do believe in. You see, back about a decade ago, my husband and I, we thought we were going to conquer the world. We knew that there would be bumps in the roads here and there, but we were going to have our fairy tale. We had agreed that we were going to have 2 kids, a golden retriever, and a white picket fence. I grew up watching old black and white movies and Leave It to Beaver, so my young, naive self believed in the fairy tale. And why wouldn't it? But then life happened. Unexpected out-of-state moves, being away from family and friends, loss of a job, bills, oh, so many bills. The water heater breaks, the dog has an emergency trip to the vet. Real life happens, and you realize that, indeed, fact, life is not perfect, and it's not a fairy tale. Life is hard, and it gets messy at times. And you can feel stressed and anxiety because things did not go according to your plan. Now, this is something I've struggled with. I want things to go according to my plan. Have you ever done one of those little survey questions and it says, where do you see yourself in 5 years? Well, I bet back in 2015, if any of us filled out that survey of where do you see yourself in 5 years, I don't think a single one of us got it right by saying we were going to be living in a pandemic and running out of toilet paper. We all got it wrong. You see, we live in a very imperfect world, full of stressed out and anxious people. Anxiety disorders are some of the most common mental health concerns, and it affects about 20% of the population. Now, this is a topic that is taboo, and people don't often talk about it. Children nowadays are starting to learn to become more in tune with their emotions and talk more about it. When one of my children is having one of their daily meltdowns, I try to add to their calm, and I ask them, why are you upset? And oftentimes, it's a singular reason. I wanted that toy. A lot of times, it's because we skipped a nap, and they just don't know it. But a lot of times, it's something very specific, why they're sad. I didn't get to be line leader. I wanted that sippy cup. But as adults, it's hard. I don't know about you, but there are often days when I feel grumpy and sad and stressed, and it's not because I didn't get the toy I wanted. It's because of about 30 things that didn't go the way it was supposed to go that day, and I start to feel a little stressed. And then my husband walks in and asks me, how are we doing on this month's budgets? And he just stepped on a landmine. Now, I drive myself to the edge of insanity every single December, working towards perfection. We have a Christmas tree, like I'm sure many of you do, and if you've ever had 2 young children in the house, you know that you spend the entire month of December praying that some of the ornaments remain intact for Christmas morning. Now, I have since replaced my very nice nativity set with a $5 one from Target because I know I am not going to tempt fate or my 4-year-old, and it has been packed away for some years now. Now, in the midst of our already busy lives of Christmas, we have to try and visit Santa, because Santa needs to know what you want. But you can't just visit Santa. You need to buy the perfectly coordinating children's outfits to remember this stressful, wonderful time of year. Now, this year, my children were unwilling to participate in this, and we did not get a chance to go and see Santa, and they still have their unworn outfits, and I have no picture to prove it. And then Christmas cards need to get mailed out. We're not even going to start talking about that one. And then on Christmas Eve, I make my 100-plus-year-old great-grandmother snickerdoodle recipe. You see, my husband and my father don't share much in common, but they share a love of the snickerdoodle recipe and bourbon. And they have since convinced our 5-year-old that Santa's favorite cookie is in fact a snickerdoodle, and they must be made. Now, each year I lovingly make the snickerdoodles for Santa, and we did leave out a beverage that was milk, not bourbon, let the record show that, in order for a good return. And then I stay up into the wee hours in the morning every Christmas, making sure that Santa did indeed get everything on their list. Not that Santa isn't capable of checking his list twice, but I always feel the need just to make sure that everything gets placed perfectly under the tree. And then once again, Christmas morning comes, the children are in perfectly coordinating Christmas jammies, so I can look back in my old age of how cute our children were. And by noon on December 25th, I am exhausted of running around searching for perfection for the past month. I want my children to look back at their childhood and see Norman Rockwell. Now, if that isn't searching for perfection, I don't know what is. Now let's rewind back to the year 2015. You know, the year where we got it all wrong of where we would see ourselves in 5 years. I was in what it seemed to be like my 1,000th year of being pregnant as we awaited our first child, Emery. And this was 3 days before she was born in the hot, hot summer. Like literally, she was born the very end of June. I was pregnant on the summer solstice. I thought I was never going to not be pregnant ever again. But it was about 3 days before I had her, and so Travis and I, we thought we'd sneak out for one last date. Since it was incredibly hot, we figured we'd go to a movie, and nothing was really jumping out at us, but the Disney Pixar movie Inside Out was playing, so we jumped on the opportunity to be in a cool movie theater, and we watched it. Now, how many of you today have seen the movie Inside Out? Well, it's been about 5 years, or a little over 5 years, since this movie's been out, so I don't feel bad about ruining the plot and the ending for you right now. Now, it's a really cute movie, and I would recommend seeing it if you haven't, but the movie Inside Out is about an 11-year-old girl named Riley, and she's going through big life changes. Like, being 11 isn't a big enough life change. Her parents are moving from their home in Minnesota. Riley has friends and is on the hockey team, but she's excited about her move. Her dad got a job in San Francisco, so they pack up everything and hit the road. Now, at first, Riley is excited about the new adventure, but along the way, she starts to doubt this decision. And in the movie, we see that Riley is introduced to 5 emotions. The first being joy. And joy is happy and peppy and positive as can be, and it was perfect because it was just her and Riley for the first 33 seconds of her life. Then sadness showed up. And if you've ever been around a newborn, you can concur that those are pretty much the 2 emotions that you get, happiness and sadness. Then along the way, 3 more emotions show up, fear, disgust, and anger. And you see those emotions take control, or they live in the headquarters in Riley's head. When Riley's team wins the hockey game, there's joy. And when it starts to rain outside, there's sadness. And when Riley is running through the house, she sees an electrical cord and she almost trips on it, but there's fear to hold her back. And when her dad tries to feed her broccoli, there's disgust, as sassy as ever. And when she's told to go clean her room, there's anger right at the controls, ready to push the button of the one bad word that she knows. Now, as Riley is trying to navigate this new move to an unfamiliar city and strange California pizza that has broccoli on it, that disgust does show up for, she starts to reflect on the memories and the emotions that she felt in her early childhood. Joy and sadness are her 2 main emotions, and joy is trying so hard to prevail, but there is always sadness, always there at the controls. Now, it comes to a head, and Riley buys a bus ticket back to Minnesota. She's running away from her new home back to her old life where it was perfect. They had regular cheese pizza. She had her hockey friends. But then something happens. Sadness starts to talk to joy and show her that behind every pure, happy memory, like winning the hockey game, sadness was also right there. In the process of winning the game, Riley missed an opportunity to score a shot, and she thought that she had let her team down. You see, Riley learns that you can't experience the joy of happiness without first going through the feeling of sadness. I know, really deep for a Pixar movie, but Pixar got it right. So often in life, we don't want to experience the pain, the loss, the sadness, the defeat. We just want to experience the happy ending, the joy, the celebration, the champagne, as it will be. But you see, what happens is in life is we fail. We struggle to the journey to joy. It can often come at a price. Now, I have shared that I have a sign in my house that reads, "God grant me patience right now." And I don't really like to walk through the trials. But then again, who really does? I have times where on my walk with God, I've yelled up to the heavens and had a curt conversation with God, pleading that I've learned the lesson, that this is unbearable, I'm ready for the joy. Can we just get to the joy and to the celebration? I'm ready for my champagne, happy Norman Rockwell ending. And if we can get there in 90 minutes like you do in the movies, that would be even better. But you see, life is not perfect. Things do not get figured out in 90 minutes, and our version of perfection is still pending. For reasons I cannot explain, God keeps us in a trial period that is seemingly unfair and uncomfortable. Now, years before I had children, I heard a story that I would like to share with you guys today. It comes from a woman named Emily Kinsley, and it is titled, Welcome to Holland. And this is how the story goes. I am often asked to describe the experience of raising a child with a disability, to try and help people who have not shared this unique experience to understand it, to imagine how it would feel. And it goes like this. When you're going to have a baby, it's like planning a fabulous vacation, a trip to Italy. You buy a bunch of guidebooks and you make wonderful plans. The Colosseum, the Michelangelo David, the gondolas in Venice. You may even learn a handy phrase or two in Italian, and it's all very exciting. And after months and months of eager anticipation, the day has finally arrived. You pack your bags and off you go. And then several hours later, the plane lands. And the stewardess comes on and says, Welcome to Holland. Holland? You say, what do you mean, Holland? I signed up for Italy. I'm supposed to be in Italy. All my life I have dreamed of going to Italy. But there's been a change in the flight plans. They've landed in Holland, and you must stay. The important thing is that they haven't taken you to a horrible, disgusting, filthy place full of pestilence and famine and disease. It's just a different place. You must go out, and you must buy new guidebooks. You must learn a whole new language, and you will meet a whole new group of people you never would have met. It's just a different place, a slower pace than Italy, less flashy than Italy, but after you've been there for a while, you catch your breath, you look around, and you begin to notice Holland has windmills, and Holland has tulips, and Holland even has Rembrandts. But everyone you know is going back and forth from Italy. And they're bragging about all the wonderful times they had. And for the rest of your life, all you can say is, yes, that's where I was supposed to go. That's what I had planned. And the pain of that will never, ever, ever go away, because the loss of a dream is a significant one. But if you spend your life mourning the fact that you didn't get to go to Italy, you may never be free to enjoy the very special, the very lovely things about Holland. I know, really deep story for a Sunday morning, isn't it? You see, my family, in a way, got to visit Italy once with the birth of our first daughter. Then we booked our second trip with our son, and our plane got rerouted. At first, things looked like Italy, but over time, we started to notice that we were, in fact, not in Italy, but in Holland. We were in over a year's worth of endless amounts of medical appointments, tests, and therapy. And questionnaires. And then about 10 days before Kansas City started a shutdown because of COVID-19, we learned that he had cancer. We're trying to navigate this diagnosis in the midst of a pandemic, like things weren't already hard enough. And I've gone through the five emotions of inside out probably a few million times in the past 6 months. Joy. Joy that we finally were able to find out what was causing our son's symptoms. Sadness. Sadness maybe doesn't even quite describe it, but more like complete despair. Going from normal one morning in our living room to every parent's worst nightmare by the evening. I'm not the same person that I used to be. That's okay. This is a part of our journey. And I hope that one day we'll be able to come back. But right now in my life, sadness is at the helm. It's at the headquarters. And that's okay. It's okay to not be okay. Anger? Yep, me and anger have become very, very well acquainted over the past few months. Angry that the doctors did not take our concerns more seriously sooner. Anger, for reasons that we will never be able to explain, children get cancer. And it's not something that I feel that any child should ever have to go through. And I am still angry at that. And I will more than likely be a little bit angry with God every day for the rest of my life. And then we have disgust. Disgust is defined as an emotional response to something unpleasant, to reject something. And let's just say that's a good thing that Travis and I had friends before our son's diagnosis, because we are making no new friends along the way, and I'll leave it at that. Then lastly, we have fear. This one I feel is wrapped up in every moment of our everyday lives. You see, I am a type A perfectionist planner. I like to know what is going to happen. And with this, I am not in control. I don't know what the outcome will be. We pray for the best, but we have literally had to have conversations that no parent should ever have to have beside their two-year-old. You prepare for the worst every day. You begin to guard your heart. You have small moments of joy when sadness and fear are right there to tell you to cherish this moment and put it in your memory, because you are in fact not guaranteed to have more of these. Faith over fear is what I try to tell myself. I don't know if I believe it myself, but I often whisper it to myself. Faith over fear. Almost a decade ago, when I married my husband, we promised to love each other for better or for worse, and I apologized to him all the time that I am not doing better and that today is a bad day. He gets me at my worst. I am a neurotic mess most of the time. I am not the young person that he married for in thinking of a champagne happy ending. So thank you to Travis, for reasons I cannot explain, still loves me. I wish that you could see more of my joy and less of my sadness and anger and fear. And you have to remind me all too often to find the joy. I only see the fact that I am stuck in Holland and I want out. The Norman Rockwell of perfection that I have in my brain is still not there. Perfection in my eyes is still pending. And it is hard to remind myself that we are walking through these trials for a reason. I get angry with God. Why did one of my children get to go to Italy and the other to Holland? My prayer is that we will get to Italy or some version of Italy one day, but we're going to have to work painfully, painfully hard to get there. There are a lot of us Christians out there who work very, very hard to make all things happy and joyful and seemingly perfect, but every moment along our path doesn't have to be joyful. And as we see in the film Inside Out, many of our most happy, our core memories, are preceded by moments of sadness. Part of our emotional health is being able to integrate all of those emotions that sometimes seem unattractive. We find that they all have a place in who we are meant to be. It's only through owning, embracing, and acknowledging those unattractive, non-joyful emotions that we allow God's healing and resurrection power to move in our lives. I'd like to thank everybody today for coming to my pity party. But the reason why I probably overshare my sermons is because I want you to know more about me. It's a two-way street. This is my opportunity to let people peek into the window of our lives. Now, this struggle, this non-perfect, non-joyful situation that my family is going through right now, does not make us special. Unfortunately, misery, in a sense, loves company. We're in a horrible club of parents with very sick children. Then, about a week and a half after our son was diagnosed with cancer, this thing happened. I don't know if you've heard of it, COVID-19. And shelter in place and personal distancing became part of our new vocabulary. Our world was crashing down around us, and in a sense, the world stopped with us for a moment to share in our pain. And over these last few months, I think to myself, and I have to assure myself, that we have all felt these five emotions. Now, these statements are general, so please don't get mad at me, but I'm sure in these past few months, many of you maybe have felt joy. Joy that it's not me or any of my loved ones that are sick. Joy of getting a new pet in your family since you're home more often. Joy that you get to clean out that closet or watch too much TV. Joy that you get to spend an extra once-in-a-lifetime moment with your spouse and children. For many of us, we've also experienced sadness. Sadness that someone we love has fallen ill or died because of this. Sadness and mourning that we cannot do things that make us us. We are social creatures and having to struggle greatly with being isolated. I'm sure that we've all gone through some part of a mourning process. Maybe you feel anger that things are closed, anger that things are opened, anger that plans got canceled, anger that you have to wear a mask, anger that people aren't choosing to wear a mask, anger at how things are being held, angry at how people may view COVID-19. But anger, that's life, that life is not going how you envisioned it. And maybe you are in fear that things will never go back to quote unquote normal, fear of a second wave, fear of how the economy will do. And maybe you have some disgust, which ties a little bit into some of the examples of anger. We're all feeling different things right now for different reasons and at different stages, and that's okay. Everyone's emotional processes of this situation is going to take time, more time than what I think a lot of us think. And it's okay. It's okay to have moments of joy in this. It's okay to have moments of anger. It's okay to feel what you are feeling. We just need to realize that in the midst of this very hard, confusing, unprecedented time, to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. I know, so much harder and easier said than done. But as our scripture reading today states, that there is a season for everything and everything mattered. God has made everything fitting in his time. And throughout my greatest time of struggle, I have seen who I can draw closer to in deeper support and friendship. I struggle with knowing that God is in control. I question why would God be making me or others that I know go through these painful trials. And I must remind myself that in the midst of our trials, God has not left our side, that God is good all the time, that even though I don't see the meaning in God's plan, that all in time will be unveiled. It just takes more time and more patience, more than 90 minutes. So until I'm able to fully see God's plan for our little family and for COVID-19, I will remain sitting here in Holland. Maybe you are in Holland too this morning, knowing that perfection is still pending, knowing that it's okay to feel angry for being in this season that we don't want to be in. I need to remind myself that my husband is on the same team as me, for he sees my fear and anger more often than he sees my joy. And I know that I am never truly alone, even though there are days where I feel like I'm on an island, because God is still with us on this path. The walk through Holland, I need to do a better job of seeing the tulips and the windmills. They're there. I just need to be willing more to let joy in to see them. Because God has a reason and a meaning for everything that will result in all of us standing before him in awe of his divine grace. Let us close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for this time of worship together so that we are reminded again that we are not alone. You, Almighty God, are always with us. We can place our trust in you, for you will not fail us. Please continue to be in our walk and journey throughout whatever season of life we are in. We are your people, Almighty God. We are on different paths, but some of us are on paths of pain. Some of us are on paths of joy. But we know and take comfort that you will never lead far side, as all of our paths lead to your loving arms. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us this morning for our hour of worship. It is now time for our generosity moment. You will see, if you're joining us streaming, that there is a Give Now button. You can also donate through our website, stjohnsumc.org. Thank you so much for your continued faithfulness and your loving generosity. Your donations make it possible for us to help out with our partners at Neighbor to Neighbor to provide meal and clothing for the homeless in Kansas City. They allow us to provide diapers and other necessity items at Baby Grace for those who are not able to provide the basic needs for their children. Thank you also for your donations to Rainbow Network so that we are able to help support the education of children that you will never get a chance to meet, but you're helping further and better their lives. So thank you so, so much this morning for listening to us and for your continued generosity. Thank you.
Save the
So our hymn of sending forth this morning is From All That Dwell Below the Skies. It's United Methodist hymn number 101. We're going to sing together stanzas 1, 2, and 4. At home, you are welcome to stand and join us as we sing.
Thank you.
want to remind you, if you have not already signed in, we would appreciate you doing that. Again, there is a sign-up link that came out this morning on our email to everyone, as well as you can put your names in the comments on Facebook or on our live stream. Don't forget, take an opportunity to read through all the invitations that are included in your worship guide. They are for you. As I said earlier, also take an opportunity to read your Friday ministry news. It'll have everything in it for this week and for the weeks to come that will keep you informed. As we go forth, receive this blessing as you go today. May you go in grace and in peace. May you go knowing the blessings of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, for they are truly yours now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.